assistant coach Kenny McCudden, the skills coach for the Blue Jackets. Word yesterday that he has been nominated, elected into the Illinois Hockey Hall of Fame. How about that for Kenny McCudden? A great honor. And yesterday after practice, Coach Tortorella gathered the team around and told the team, look at the response. Does that give you some idea of how popular Kenny McCudden is? He gets the stick taps. And a guy like Jared Bull, who was instrumental in bringing Kenny here, also had a big part in that celebration yesterday, as did John Tortorella. Listen, you can't say enough about what Kenny has done to this team, and he was very proud to get those stick taps after practice.
You don't work for things like that, but I guess when you pay the price for 30 years with kids and pros and college players and all sorts of hockey, they recognize you for it, and it's a thrill. An absolute thrill to have Bowler come to me yesterday and say, when is the date for the event, because I want to be there. I said, well, I'll buy you a ticket. And so Bowler and I have had this little bit of a life that's gone full circle from kid to pro, and now we're coaching together. So it's a wonderful game, isn't it?
Kenny's coached at every level, from minor hockey. He's coached 125,000 children in North America. He was a skills coach with the U.S. national program that competed in the 2014 Sochi Olympics. He works in summer months with junior players and two college teams. Kenny was inducted into the Hall of Fame in January of 2020. I have known Kenny since my time with the Chicago Wolves. He and I worked together on the ice as he was the skills coach and I was learning. I still use, as of today, a lot of the techniques and philosophies that Kenny shares with me. Kenny, my friend, let's go get him, buddy.
JP, thanks for having me on. Really, really appreciate this. And I want to start off by thanking everybody that's going to be part of this. And about 7 weeks ago, I started these video phone conference calls because I think we're all starving for hockey here throughout the world with this COVID crisis. So I believe I'm up to 43 or 44 hours worth of doing these. And talking to other countries, talking to states here in the States, from, for instance, if I talk, which I'm quite surprised I haven't done yet, but I'm sure that will be on the agenda very soon. But I want to say thank you for having me, first of all. And yes, we do go back, JP. I always appreciated you as a pro because you were all about bettering yourself every single year and having the best preparation going into the season. You lived in my house for at least 4 years at 2 weeks at a time. And you wanted to go twice a day. And those were days where my pro groups were very, very small. Or during that time you were here, they were very, very small. But that's all changed today. But I really respected your ways because this is something I want to bring up today. You were all about pro habits and at the highest level. And that's why you played at the highest level. You wanted the very, very best. You wanted change. You wanted progressive development. And that's what you got from a guy like myself. And I think that's why we had such a great relationship. But today, with everybody jumping in, I'd like you, like JP said, just to say your name and where you're coaching, because it gives me an idea how to answer your question a little bit better. But I'd like to cover everything from working with kids from 7 years old to 16 or 17, junior hockey, college hockey, pro hockey, the Columbus Blue Jackets, John Tortorella. I'm open for anything and everything. And I want to get into questions right away because the majority of these calls that I've done so far on these video conference calls, they've been lasting roughly about 2 hours. And the reason why, I wanted the forum to be completely open with all levels of hockey, all levels of coaching. And the reason why, we can learn something from the highest level, and I can still learn something from the very, very lowest level, because I haven't been around it a whole lot lately in the last 5 years at the might level or squirt level here in the States. But we can all learn something. So, again, I want to say thank you. And anybody that wants to jump in to start off the night, feel free. Welcome.
I got one for you, Kenny. We've discussed in the past modifying a player's stride or taking it over and totally changing it. What is your philosophy on that stride?
Well, I'll tell you what, we can end this right now with one answer. As far as when it comes to development, my answer is always to work around an athlete. I am not there to change an athlete. Now we're talking at a high level. I'm not there to change them. I'm working around that athlete. As far as kids hockey, when it comes to a stride, obviously you're teaching the fundamentals and you want to get that kid along, girl or boy, to the highest level or whatever the next level might be. But tearing down a stride, I think the only way you would do that, JP, is if, you know, if you're working with a group of kids that were only skating twice a week where they played one game and had one practice and you were teaching power skating. I can see if you had 30 kids like that on the ice and they were beginner skaters, of course, you're reconstructing the stride. But when we're getting the better talented kids at 10 years old, 12 years old, I'm still with working around it and hammering out the fundamental side. But at the highest level, I'm not going to go in my business and work with Zach Werenski or Seth Jones and reconstruct their stride. There's just no way that that's going to happen. They have reached a certain level as a college player has, as a junior player has, and there's really, really no reason, I don't think, to break down a stride when those players have made that level. There's still ways to get better, and we can add to it, but to break it down, I'm not that type of coach.
Hey, Kenny. Great to
Hi,
see
Ryan.
You.
Good
Thanks
to see
for
you.
Doing this.
You're
really
very welcome.
Appreciate you doing that. I guess, like, for me, I've been working with, like, JP for a couple years, and my kids are in hockey, so I'm kind of at those grassroots kind of levels. And then also working with Team Manitoba as well.
Yep.
I guess right now, like with Team Manitoba, we're looking at our skills and skill development and where we kind of go and how we want to improve it from that level. Now, it'd be awesome to just be able to work with kids that are young and help them all the way through, but we don't always have that luxury. And sometimes we do have a player that's 17 or 18 years old. And we might have limited time to work with them. I guess not knowing all the players, but you kind of know the game really, really well, that if we had maybe two skills that we really, really needed to focus on for our players, what would those skills be, like the very essential things?
Well, it's a great question. Easy answer for me. Number one, skating, obviously. The old saying that Gretzky said 35, 40 years ago, if you can't skate, you can't play the game. So I've got to go with that right off the bat. Number two, I would have to say the combination of puck handling and stick handling to go, Ryan, with the skating. I mean, it always made me laugh in the past. Like, for instance, here in Illinois with Illinois hockey, which is very, very competitive here in Chicago. But I always used to laugh at power skaters that power skated kids with no pucks for like 10 weeks. Never understood it. The game is played with a puck. And kids have to make plays with a puck. So working on edge work continuous, it never was a thing of me as far as how I tried to teach. I wanted to bring the combination of skating and puck control and stick handling together. But when you can get a kid that can fly without a puck, and we know all kids and all athletes get, you know, that are decent enough skaters, the way they can maneuver without a puck, now let's put a puck on their stick and let's see what they can do with that puck. So that's where you're asking me two skills. I want to say three skills. And you're going to ask me what is the difference between these two. So I already answered skating, and I said puck handling and stick handling. And I'm looking at puck handling and stick handling as two different things. Stick handling is moving the puck across your body. Puck handling is in certain situations where you're dragging it with your body and there's no hand movement whatsoever. So I differentiate the two of handling a puck and stick handling a puck. Stick handling a puck can be from 10 o'clock to 2 o'clock. Puck handling would be, for instance, if I'm a lefty, if I start out right over left on my backhand, I'm pulling and dragging that across my body. Or if I beat somebody off the half wall to drive the net, I'm pulling away from the play for a short time, and then I may get into a stick handling mode. So I do separate the two. But those three skills, Ryan, are the three that I'd be working with kids continuous. Skating, puck handling, and stick handling. Shooting will come.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Kenny.
Thanks, Ryan. And Ryan, anybody that wants to ask two or three or four questions, feel free. I'd like to keep the rhythm going. On a lot of these calls, I mean, I've had coaches that have asked five questions, which is totally fine that you keep on coming back. So no questions, a silly question. So great, great question, Ryan. Thank you.
All right. Mr. Jamie Kagan, you had your finger up. Give us what you
I
got.
I did. Can you hear me?
Yep.
So I have an older boy and younger kids, but the younger guys are coming out of half ice where there's no structure. It's 4-on-4. And my guy's now going to move to the traditional ice next year. And as sort of a coach, it's a real struggle of, okay, how do you explain to someone who's played 3 years of 4-on-4 half ice, where do you even start in terms of, okay, this is what the game really looks like?
Another outstanding question. And I'm ready to answer all of these because when JP said that I've worked with 125,000 kids, that's the honest truth throughout North America. I'm very, very fortunate with my career at youth and minor hockey. I mean, very, very lucky. But I think you're going to have to go to a lot of whiteboard, a lot of teaching off the ice to start off right off the bat. Don't try to bring that teaching to the ice because ice is such a commodity and you don't want to be wasting it whatsoever. So stopping play all the time on the ice, bringing kids over to the whiteboard, bringing them to a knee, it doesn't make any sense to me. Whereas whatever you're trying to convey on the ice, you can get a head start by doing that off the ice, on the whiteboard, in classroom and that type of thing. But it sounds like you're going to have to get to the nuts and bolts of teaching away from being on the ice just so they're prepared a little bit better on the ice and you're not wasting that ice time. Because too many coaches today, when you go through rinks today, you'll see kids on their knee. Well, if you've got an hour slot and you're seeing kids on their knee 2 minutes here, 3 minutes here, there's 5 minutes out of an hour program completely wasted when they could have been working on skills. So get to the whiteboard and try to teach as much as you can in a classroom atmosphere.
And just following up on that, part of the problem right now is they've played sort of like as a herd for a while.
Yep.
How do you sort of teach a kid to stay off the pocket and have some spatial awareness? Because, you know, you talk in the dressing room, but then they go on the ice and they go back to what they know, which is that big rolling cluster.
Yeah, that cluster, you know, I mean, that's why we're all coaches, to be able to teach and lead and make these kids better with very, very progressive development. But that cluster is going to be a hard one for you because they're all like magnets to the puck right now by the sounds of it. And what I would personally do, I would get into station work and I would get into competing with station work. I would get into 2-on-2. I'd get into 1-on-1 just so they get away from what you describe as a cluster. But that 2-on-2, I mean, we get back at it in a major, major way when we're not playing at the highest level, when we're not playing well, we get back to a teaching. If we have a teaching week, we get into 2-on-2s and 3-on-3s all the time. But I know you want to get away from the 4-on-4. So 2-on-2 and 1-on-1 and a lot of station work. Now you talk about vision, seeing the ice a little bit better because they won't see it in a cluster with 4-on-4. When you have 8 players on the puck at the age that you're talking about and where they came from, there's going to be zero vision. So I think their vision is going to open up a little bit more with 1-on-1. 2-on-2 on what they have to do. Even 3-on-3, it's completely different than the 4-on-4 that they're used to. But I would really get them into a lot of playmaking drills where their vision, they're looking out and being able to see the whole entire ice, the whole entire zone. So for instance, if you've got defensemen up at the blue line doing a certain play and walking the line, you don't want that defenseman just to be able to see where the strong side was. You want to be able to see the strong side. You want to see up the gut, and you want to be able to see the weak side. Same thing down low for forwards, to be able to see the play outwards. of what's coming into them. And that'd be the exact same thing. Not only seeing the strong side, let's see the middle of the ice, and let's see the weak side. So you're using that whole entire zone. But teach the kids as much as you can to be able to use their vision, to be able to look out and see the ice as much as possible instead of just seeing the play around them.